Cobalt supports two types of macros. One type is called a button macro, or simply macro. The other type is called an action macro and is based on text that you type into the system. Button macros should be used for simple commands. The way that you create button macros is by learning them, and we learn them using the miscellaneous soft keys. You type the number of the macro you want to learn, so 1, learn macro, and the system starts recording every button hit you make after that point. You know you're in macro recording mode because recording macro appears in the top corner of all of your screens. The challenge of button macros is that the Cobalt system is essentially context-free. Because you can do anything in any order, it's hard to establish a button macro that does what you expect. I'll give you a short example using just the browser key. I'm going to make a macro that double taps the browser dock button. Okay? When I'm done, I'm going to use the mouse and I'm going to click on recording macro, and that's going to stop the recording mode. I have to use the mouse or the touchscreen in this case because I can tell the system not to learn that particular action. Any other action, like using the escape key, for example, will be learned into your macro. When I execute macro 1 by typing 1 and hitting the macro key, it actually runs so fast that you can't see the browser move. So one of the things I can do to macros is I can tell them to run in real-time mode, and that's by opening up the macro list in general settings in the browser and ticking that box. I can give myself a name for this macro so I remember what the heck it does. So now when I execute macro 1 macro, you'll notice that it ran 1 and that it closed the browser. Last time I executed this macro, or when I learned it, it closed and opened the browser. The difference between those two moments in time is that I was focused on the browser and the browser was open when I learned the macro. I execute macro 1 again. It's going to focus on the browser and open and close it again. And this is just what browser does in this particular state. If I open the browser and hit browser again, I get a different behavior. This is the danger of a button macro, in that the way it's written can really affect what the actual outcome of that button macro is going to be. So button macros should always be for commands where you can be really certain of what the outcome will be. A lot of times people need to use macros to automate playback in the system. We have the action macros for that purpose. An action macro can be assigned to a step of a sequence, or it can be written into a list and executed by a direct select button. I'll show you in this show file how the sequence steps have action macros on them. I'll close the browser so we have a little bit of extra room. Here are my steps, and if I arrow all the way over to the right, I'll find the action macro column. And you can see as we move down the sequence that occasionally there's an action macro inserted. And this action macro is a command that tells the masters to change their master page. Simply write in page 1, comma 1 to change the bottom set of masters, or masters 1 through 20, to use page 1. Later in the show, this step will tell those same masters 1 through 20 to switch to page 2. So this is one way of using action macros, is to relate things you do on the main playback to actions that happen on the masters. You can find out more about what action macros are available to you by searching for them in the help system. Just search for action macro and go to the first link that appears in the help system. On this page, you'll find all of the commands that are available for your use in Action Macros and how to configure them to do what you expect. Action Macros can also be placed on buttons, and the way that you do that is by going into the Action Macro list in the browser. So my Action Macro list is currently empty. I'll type one insert to create a new one. I'm going to call this M10 up. And I'll type in the actual macro in the content cell. The command we're going to use here to move a master fader to a position is called start. And the action macro is start M10 to indicate master 10, comma 100 to indicate to move the master fader from 0 to full, comma 10 to move that master fader in 10 seconds. And actually, for the sake of this demo, I'm going to move it in 1 second. And when I'm done, I hit modify, and that locks the editing cell. I can close that list view now, and I can go to my direct selects and change the type of information to action macro. And now you can see that my first button in the action macro area is called M10 up, which is the text I added to this particular macro. And when I push that button, master 10 is pushed up to full in 1 second. I could have equally written that macro onto a step of a sequence, or if I'm doing work here in the direct selects, then I can create buttons that execute playbacks for me. It doesn't have to be a master that's in front of me. It could be any of the 80 masters that are available in the system. I could then make corresponding action macros that push that fader back down, that advance sequences on the masters, or do things in combination, like push all the masters down or push only some of the masters down or up or whatever. To combine commands, simply add a semicolon and then type the next one. Start M9, 50. No time value, it'll snap the value in. So now I've just adjusted that action macro, and now it should move two faders. One in time and one in a snap. So you can make that button be as complex or as simple as you need it to be. And those are action macros.